All right, gentlemen, hit it.
Howdy folks, I'm Dan Gross, and welcome to the final Spotlight special of the Rochester Indie Musician Spotlight, Rochester's premier music and interview show. We're here with Daniel Bennett. Now, Daniel, we have the pleasure of having Daniel on as our first out-of-town guest, but Daniel's a Rochester native, and everywhere he goes, he talks about Rochester, so I wanted to bring him in and chat about all of the things Daniel does, talking about Rochester, what he does in his music, and a little bit of his Twitter feed, too. So, Daniel, thanks for joining us.
This episode is brought to you by Bernunzio Uptown Music, Bop Shop Records, and Rowe Photo. Bernunzio Uptown Music, located in Rochester's East End, has been providing Rochester and the world with quality vintage, new, and used string instruments since 1976. Bernunzio also offers concerts, workshops, and jam sessions. This season, we're in this warm, local, and creative space, Bop Shop Records. Located right outside the city at 1460 Munro Avenue, Bop Shop Records is your Rochester home for blues, classic rock, jazz, and Americana roots music in vinyl for the past 35 years. Rowe Photo is your one-stop shop for photo, home theater installation, audio, and accessory needs. For three generations since 1898, Rowe Photo is there for you with second-to-none customer service. Stop by Rowe Photo's two convenient locations today.
So much to talk about.
Yeah, there's always a lot to talk about.
It's good to be here, Dan. Thank you for having us. And by the way, born and raised in Honeyoy Falls, New York. And
that's
it's
right.
Honeyoy, not Hanoya. Honeyoy.
You get Hanoya?
I get Hanoya, and it's Honeyoy Falls, and then there's the town of Honeyoy, separate,
oh.
Different towns.
So right, we're setting the record straight right here.
But yes, we are, and you know what? I will say this too, the Bop Shop, it was like my home away from home as a kid, growing up in Rochester,
yeah,
coming
Village
here.
Gate.
Oh yeah, when it was at the Village Gate, I would do two things. I would go to the Yankee Clipper, which is the toy store at the Village Gate, which is still there, unbelievably. Wow, amazing place. Buy some vintage toys there, and then I would go over to the Bop Shop and buy records.
You had it all figured out.
I had it all figured out.
So when did you start playing sax in this town of ours?
I started when I was young. Hmm. I first heard a kid named Chris Oldfield play the saxophone. Everyone has this story, so
right.
I looked up to this kid. I still look up to him. He's a great musician. He actually is a music teacher in Rochester. And my sister took me to a high school band concert. I was in fourth grade, and Chris Oldfield got up on stage and played the Pink Panther.
Mm.
And that was it. I was hooked. I couldn't believe he was getting that sound out of his saxophone.
Yeah.
And so my sister, actually, she knew Chris, so she got us, she kind of connected us, and I did lessons with him for a little while, and he just kind of got me off in running. Yeah.
Yeah. What drew you to what's the list? It's flute, oboe, alto, sax. What else do you play for Daniel Bennett Group?
Well, you know, for this particular tour, we've been touring all week. We were in Pittsburgh last night. I'm only traveling. I've got my alto saxophone, flute, and oboe on this trip.
Mm-hmm.
But I do clarinet as well, bass clarinet, all that. And nowadays, it's just expected. If you're a woodwind player, you're going to double.
That's
you're a saxophonist, you're going to double. I do a lot of theater gigs in New York, so they often, to save money, they will hire one or two woodwind guys to just play everything.
Right.
And so, you know, then you have to, like, kind of pull your hair out, making sure that you can play the oboe and flute and piccolo and sax. But saxophone's my main instrument.
I was just about to say, alto sax is still your main squeeze.
Mm-hmm.
So was alto the first thing you picked up? Because you mentioned, I mean, Chris was, like, the guy.
Mm-hmm.
Was it alto immediately, or were you, like, a convert?
Yeah. No, it was alto immediately. And the first piece I played was a piece called Aria by Eugene Botza, a French composer, who wrote a lot of great saxophone music. A lot of the classical saxophone repertoire is from French composers, like Ibert, Gazenclos, Dahl, Glazunov. So I studied a lot of that as a kid, and then obviously Chris was a jazz player, so we did a lot of jazz right off the bat, too. So I was just kind of immersing myself. And then I took lessons with another great saxophonist in Rochester named Greg Knapp. Greg is a composer, and he kind of got me into the world of composing and just thinking more in the big scale of things when I listen to music.
we've known each other for about a year now. Mm-hmm. We've had a couple conversations about this. You have a wide set of eclectic influences. Not everyone grows up listening to a bunch of different stuff, and how you integrate it's really interesting. But let's sort of talk about growing up. What were some of the things you were really listening to and you were gravitating towards when you were younger that are sort of more present now?
It's funny you mentioned that. We drove by the old fairgrounds in Henrietta, and yeah. When I was a kid, I used to go see Peter, Paul, and Mary with my parents in John Denver. Mm. They would play, and they would shoot these hot air balloons up into the sky. You know, people would get in the hot air balloons and fly around, and we would look at the hot air balloons and listen to Peter, Paul, and Mary in the field. I mean, it was great, and fireworks and all this stuff. So as a kid, I was listening to that a lot, folk music, American folk rock, stuff like that. But also being a Rochester kid, I was into, you know, Chuck Mangione, Gap Mangione. My parents got me into Jerry Nywood, Steve Gadd. I did an interview with a radio thing, and we were talking about the concert in Central Park with Simon and Garfunkel, and how half of that band was actually guys from Rochester.
No kidding.
Yeah, Steve Gadd, Jerry Nywood. Yeah. I mean, just like a whole fleet of Rochester people. So I was into that. Hill Where the Lord Hides was my favorite song as a kid. It was the Rochester Philharmonic and Chuck Mangione and all this crazy. Chris Vidal, is that his name? Vidal, yeah. He was on that. Jerry Nywood. It was great.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like a great environment to grow up in. And you've thankfully, we really appreciate you going on tour and talking about what a great musical place Rochester was to come up. And you continued your education. You didn't just go, you know, into primary school, but you also went to college in Rochester, right?
I did. I went to Roberts Wesleyan College, and actually, that's kind of how you and I connected about a year ago.
Yeah.
My band played a concert at Shoe and Recital Hall at Roberts, my alma mater. Phenomenal school. I learned everything at Roberts, everything, all-encompassing, body, heart, mind, and soul, music. I was a music major. You know, what can I say? I met Sean Jefferson there. We were talking about Sean Jefferson.
Right. Shout out Sean Jefferson.
Shout outs, and I'll say a few more. I met Ryan Barclay.
Yeah.
Some really amazing musicians at Roberts. Dan Mark. I mean, just some really cool people that I still connect with. Sean and I still play a lot when I'm around town. Yeah. So yeah.
That's something I want to expand upon too. Is that Rochester is just an amazing place for original music to happen. And everyone's fortunate to have this environment and to have access to it, but you were especially fortunate being able to, I mean, you mentioned all the people you listened to, but you had an incredible caliber of people to play with.
Mm-hmm.
And you eventually, you know, went to Boston to get more degrees. But
that's a whole other story, getting more degrees. Believe me, this has been the topic of conversation on many tours. You know, it's good to get some training on your instrument, but it's also great to leave academia and go out on your own. We do about 200 tour dates a year.
That's a lot.
And believe me, what we do on the road has nothing to do with music school. Nothing. So I tell young students, we do a lot of clinics around the country, and I just tell students, you know, get your training, learn your instrument, go to school. I'm not against going to music school per se, but then get out of there and stop talking about it. Stop talking about music school. I'm going to go on a rant now. Stop talking about music. Well, you can talk about music school because this is your show and this is a great show.
You can talk about it as much as you want.
Yeah, well, I just tell people at some point, you know, let go of that and write music and compose and find your own voice.
This is something you've done particularly well. You've done this thing, which I think is brilliant and hilarious, where you say you're not defining your music anymore. You refuse to give it a genre. So you got a little bit of it at the beginning of this episode, but here are some of I've heard. I've heard surf rock. I've heard jazz pop. I've heard jazz. I've heard folk jazz. I've heard summer camp jazz. I've heard jazz minimalism meets Brian Wilson.
Yeah.
It's a lot.
Yeah, summer camp is good. I like that one, too. I've heard that.
And it fits your guys' personality.
Summer camp,
yeah. You guys are so... Yeah. This is what I love about you guys, too. You're so positive, and the positivity not just comes through interview, but through the performance as well. There's no stuffiness. There's no serious. You guys are there to have fun.
We're there to have fun. We want the audience to have fun. We do it for the audience. Yeah. Believe me, we're doing this for the audience. We don't do this for ourselves. I mean, we love doing it, but it's for the audience. And yeah, we made a decision about a year ago not to describe our music. Now, if someone has a cool description, a writer in San Francisco called us avant pop.
That's right.
And that's, you know, That's cool. I kind of like that. It's a unique description. So we go with that. But I don't describe it, because as soon as you describe what you are, you immediately set up barriers and boundaries that the listener has to kind of navigate through.
Right.
And it turns people off. So the listener doesn't want to, they don't care where you went to music school. They don't care about what, you know, all of your influences are, and and my drummer's from here, and my bass player's from here, and this guy, and we picked up this, and there's like 5% Latin music in our, and there's 6% Irish Celtic music in our. People don't care, they just want to hear it. They want to have fun and enjoy the music. We'll be right back.
this reminds me of a great quote I heard, I overheard from someone at the Jazz Fest that just came out of the La Barbara Big Band performance, which is at Kilbourne, which is, of course, mind-shattering. But I hear this person walking out, and they said, I don't like jazz, but I really love big band.
Yeah.
And so this was one of these moments where this person was so concentrated on the box.
Right,
that
on the box.
There was no paradigm.
Look, it's the only genre right now that is so self-obsessed with what are we, do we swing, what are we, what is our, you know, what
identity.
Is my, what is our identity, what, you know, who am I influenced by? It's the only style. And jazz, as we've talked about, jazz has gotten very, very stagnant because of that. In other forms of music, it's just music. You go to see a band because it's a great band.
Right.
So in jazz, we're getting too hung up on that.
Why do you think that is?
I wish I knew. I think the music schools are hurting the freedom for artists to just play. People are deathly afraid to break away from the status quo. And as we all know, the music academia is really having some problems right now. If you look at Berklee College of Music with all this crazy sex abuse scandal, I mean, this is insane. I spoke up about this about a year ago.
You did.
People thought I was crazy when I said this.
That was during that Robert Glasper interview, right?
Yeah, I spoke up and people agreed with me, but people were afraid to agree with me. And then NPR, you sent me that article, mm-hmm. NPR ran a story on what we were talking about, that there's sexism in jazz. And there are females who are very uncomfortable being around this environment, the old boys club. And so anyways, that happened, and then literally a week ago, we find out that there's all this crazy stuff going on, sex abuse at Berklee College of Music and other schools. I you know, it's not just Berklee, it's just the culture in jazz is
very narrow.
Yeah, it is, and it's painful for women who are trying to express themselves, and they don't want to feel this. They don't want to be objectified. So I think, you know, it's 2017. Everything's changed. The internet has changed things. People are breaking free of boundaries, and great things are happening. So we're moving in a great direction. I'm very positive about that. But I'm glad things are coming to light, so things can change.
You do a great job talking about this, and you're really well spoken about it. I know it's kind of hard to give sweeping general advice, but you've made a career for yourself about, you went to school, you learned the stuff in school, and then you made a decision, I'm not going to do this anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And for some people, it might not be as easy as flipping the switch. What would your advice be to any jazz musician who's looking to break the mold or find their own voice?
Try to remember who you were when you were 16, because that's actually when you were the most honest with yourself. Let's be real. When you're 16, 17 years old, that's when you're the most real and honest with what you want to do and who you are. Think about what you wanted to be at that time, and don't forget that. Don't forget that. And a lot of people will want you to forget that. They want to push you down into the middle. And this is your life. I mean, we were talking about this with your show. I mean, you made a decision to launch your show a year ago, and look at what's happening. It's a whole snowball of things. Your videos are going viral, and there's all this like activity now because you made a decision to do this, to produce the show, to put your money where your mouth is.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not happening a lot in some parts of the music scene. So I would tell people to look back at what they were when they were young.
And the other thing that you've accomplished well is you've certainly done that. I mean, we've talked about your influences growing up here in Rochester before you went to school. All those are really coming through. You've also had the pleasure and the ability to play with other musicians who have that mindset, both when you were here in Rochester and when you were at school, and then these cats are playing with now. Can you talk to us about how Nat and Matthew kind of came into the mix?
I met Matthew, the drummer, on a theater gig in New York. So I do a lot of doubling, Broadway, off-Broadway. I met Matt at a theater called The Secret Theater, and we were playing a show called The Wild Party. It was really fun, actually. Really fun show. And I just noticed that he had this perfect, perfect sense of time. And I needed someone like that to go on the road because often when we tour, we don't have a bass player.
Right.
By design. So Nat Janoff has a million pedals, and he's looping. And so I needed a drummer who could follow that.
Yeah.
And so Matt was perfect. And I knew, everybody knows Nat Janoff, guitarist. So I just knew him through some mutual friends. We met 5 or 6 years ago, and then the group formed.
Yeah, and that was, you've gone through, you bring in some more cats for some studio time, but this is kind of your core, both your core group and your touring group. So how many albums have you released with these guys?
We've done 6 albums.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's been busy.
Yeah, including the Bear Trilogy.
The Bear Trilogy, man. We did 3 albums centered around bears. The Legend of Bear Thompson, Peace and Stability Among Bears, and A Nation of Bears.
That's right. And who did the illustration for those?
Tim Banks, my brother-in-law, who's also a phenomenal illustrator. He does work for Cartoon Network. He does things for... he actually designs most of the Paste magazine covers. So if you look at Paste magazine, most of the cartoon artwork that you see is Tim Banks. So check him out.
Shout out to Tim Banks.
Yeah.
So just to sort of wrap this up, we have kind of general questions that we like to ask everybody, and we covered one of them already, which was sort of advice to artists. So the first one I'll give to you is what makes Rochester such a great place for original music to both be created and to sustain?
It's a lot of young people. Mm. There's colleges and there's young people. And then there's older people who support that and who are open-minded. So that combination is just perfect. The size of the city, the openness, and the young people, that's like the perfect mix that you need, yeah.
And then one more for you. Now, you're a philosophizer, as I like to say.
Woo!
You're a big thinker. For you, if you could accomplish one thing in music and be happy, what would it be?
Worship God and serve the people. Someone told me that when I was a kid. When I was a kid, I used to play in homeless shelters. I would play at the bus stop. I would play in homeless shelters, soup kitchens. Actually, my buddy Andrew is here today for this taping, and he would play with me. We had a band, and someone told me that. Is it worship God and serve the people? That's it. Your job is to be a servant at the end of the day. And if you do that, you'll love doing it too, because it's about others and it's not about you. Mm-hmm. So that's what I strive for.
Yeah. Beautiful and simple.
Yeah, beautiful and simple.
Daniel, thank you so much for your time, man. Well, you've watched, I think this might be the last, if not second to last, Rochester Indie Musician Spotlight, but it's the last Spotlight special for the season, so we'll see you next year. Daniel, thanks for your time, man.
Thank you, Dan. All right.